Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Meeting to order for the Alamance County Commissioners, and before we begin, I'm going to ask Roger Parker if he'll do our invocation.
Okay, be glad to. Shall we pray? Father God, we thank you for another opportunity to come here to discuss the business of Alamance County. We ask that you give us the wherewithal to make the right decision for all citizens of the county. Dear God, as you know, things just seem upside down in the United States and maybe around the world these days. What seems to be what used to be right is now wrong and so forth, and we need your help more than ever. So please put your hands on this country, on our leaders, and give them potential to make the right decisions to keep us all safe. Be with our law enforcement officers throughout the land. Be with the people down in Louisiana in the flood. Help those people, and also help people in Milwaukee to understand what's going on, get it under control, and get back to their normal life. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Now we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay. First on our agenda tonight, we have public speakers. And let's see. We have Tony Cox, your first to bat.
In your prayer, it's easy to see what the problem is. We got a bunch of second-class citizens. People think they're first-class over us, so-called second-class citizens. And until y'all first-class citizens say that our second-class citizens have the same rights as everybody else, the wars will be over. The wars will stop. But y'all create the wars. In God we trust. We need another one over here, the Ten Commandments. The first five don't matter. Over here we need the Constitution. And back here we need the Bill of Rights, so that when people in these meetings like these right here start destroying our rights and lying on us and cheating on us and stealing from us, we can go to these things and say, huh, you can't do that. But y'all don't care. You know, I have just recently come upon, and this is amazing to me, amazing. I know somebody that has just become physically disabled. And going from government building to government building in this county, county government buildings, I find that it is horrendous trying to get into their buildings in a wheelchair. Horrendous. The people that come to these buildings that are by themselves in a wheelchair, God help them. The doors don't automatically open for them. You might get somebody that opens a door for them. If you pull them behind trying to push somebody in a wheelchair, get in a wheelchair for a week and try it out. And then get on the back side of somebody else being in a wheelchair for a week, pulling their oxygen, trying to push their wheelchair, trying to get doors. Everybody's so busy, they don't care about those people in those wheelchairs no more. They're too busy texting or whatever they doing. But the money that y'all take from the citizens of this county, under, if you don't pay, we'll take your land, and people, handicapped people, can't get into these buildings. That ramp right out there to come into this building. Take somebody that has low energy in a wheelchair and try to come up that ramp. And then once you make it to the top of the ramp, where are you gonna go? And then you got these little tight quarters. Go over there to the main entrance of the social services, health department and everything. You got them double doors right there, but you can't get in. And if you're in a wheelchair and you don't have help, you need to go to the bathroom. I know for a fact on the second floor, you got a men's and a women's, and you got a little area there. It's hard to get through the door. You only get one size wheelchair when you go to that building over there, and it's a small one. This one's important. Then the patient or the person that you're trying to help, in my case, the woman had to get up out of that wheelchair and walk through the door because it was so tight right there. These people need help, and these buildings need to be handicap accessible.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you.
Okay, is it Joe Price?
Yes.
Okay, hey.
My sister's house 3 weeks ago was fired on by the next door neighbor.
Was fired?
Yeah, fired. 45 caliber bullet come through the house.
Okay.
Went through the bathroom glass. Thank God nobody was in the bathroom. They go, well, there's nothing wrong with that. He's got the right to a gun. He's not got the right to shoot a house. You know where your next door neighbor's houses are. If you can't tell me where your next door neighbor's house is, you're living somewhere else besides in the United States. You know, it's out in the county. Every single county around Alamance County has got an ordinance for a gun range. That's what he's operating over.
He's got a range.
He's got a gun range. We've had this problem for 6 years. Terry Jordan knows about it. I mean, Johnson knows about it. He's been out there several times. Told him, you know, you need to do something. Y'all passed an ordinance saying about noise. Guess what? Nothing in there says anything about a gun.
No.
45 caliber gun makes it just as much noise as anything else. Her value of her property went from $178,000 to zero. You can't sell it. You gotta disclose the next door neighbor shot the house. How are you gonna sell the property? You can't. Somebody, you need to step up and put a gun range ordinance in effect. Or put it on where the noise ordinance, where you gotta stop shooting at a certain time of night. People gotta get up every morning. He's been out in my house, next door neighbor, 2 o'clock in the morning, wide open. 3 times in a row, told him, well, we're gonna lock you up the next time. They stopped. Somebody's gotta do something.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you've got other counties coming into Alamance County, Durham County. There is a gun shop down there. If you want to shoot an AKA, guess what? We're putting you in the car. We're coming to Alamance County, and we're going over on Jim Minor Road. You can shoot gun all you want to over there. Machine guns, anything. They don't care. So, next question is she going to have to die before somebody decides to do something about a gun range? Just adopt the ordinance saying if you're going to operate a gun range, you got to meet these criteria. I'm not saying I ain't in favor of guns. I believe in hunting, everything else. But common sense is common sense. You don't go out and shoot at your next door neighbor's house and say, I'm sorry, I didn't know it was there.
I agree. Thank you very much. And we will talk about that in a minute. Lash Reitenberry.
Good evening, County Commissioners.
Good evening, Mr. Reitenberry.
Tony,
thank you for bringing that up.
Yes, sir.
And that needs to be looked into.
It does.
I have a problem with this that's on the agenda tonight, facility dude. I love Alamance County. And I don't understand why you would spend or even ask the county commissioners to spend $65,000 when you have companies out here that will come in here and do the same thing and a better job that are approved by the Department of Energy. They've done numerous projects across the state. Why would you want to pay a company $65,000? That's ridiculous. You know, taking money away from, well, he's got up and gone, the sheriff.
He's been taken away.
You know, $65,000, that's a deputy and a car for him. He had to take money and give to the schools. And I preached about this before. But I do not understand why you would even consider giving somebody $65,000 to go out and look at the buildings when you got somebody else to do the same thing and a better job. And I've seen it. But we need to address the handicap. And if we've got 40 buildings, somebody needs to sit down and look and say, hey, do we need all these buildings? We sold a prime piece of property at the end of Main Street that should have been used for a governmental center. Should never have been sold. But I love Alamance County, and I hate to see things done the wrong way, and I think there's a lot of things that need to be looked at that are not being looked at.
Thank you, sir. And I had a Penny Hawkins down for online for a comment. I'm assuming she's not here. So.
She was going to speak about park service in okay. The community. I think they're going to come back at another time. I learned from our park board meeting.
Oh, okay. Week. So you've talked to her.
I haven't talked to her, but I've talked to Scott Ryan of park, who knows.
All right. And I will open it up to commissioners' responses on the comments that we've just gotten. If anyone would like to talk about it, add to it, or whatever.
Well, I mean, isn't it mandatory that all our buildings be handicapped?
Our buildings are ADA compliant, and we, as part of our facilities improvement plan that we did back in 2011, was a lot of ADA projects. The ramp out here in front, the ramp over at Youth Services Building. So what we will be glad to do, if the board would like, we will go through with our maintenance department and do a evaluation of each building to ensure that they are ADA meeting ADA requirements. And we'll try, I'm not sure the time frame, to get with Buddy, our new maintenance director, but we'll try to have that within the next 30 days.
Yeah, I know, and I know what Tony's talking about. The doors a lot of times are one of your bigger problems to get people in and out of. Your ramps are okay, but when you get to the door, how do they get in if they're actually mobile themselves on their own? So maybe we'll discuss that a little further.
And if when we have the facility due presentation, will we not be talking about, isn't that part of the scope of service in doing our facility assessments? No?
No.
No.
I don't believe it is.
Okay.
But that's something we can do internal, and also with Robert Key, our inspections director, that's one of the things when they do valuations and inspect buildings is make sure that all our buildings are ADA compliant.
Right.
But we'll get with staff and work on a presentation back to board, hopefully within the next 30 days.
Yeah, it's like the ramps. These are ADA compliant ramps. I know they're probably hard if you're having to bring yourself up it, but that's set up by the state. And
get in a wheelchair and try.
Yeah. Well, that's I didn't write the code. I didn't write the code.
Don't matter about the code. Get in a wheelchair and try.
Well, like I said, I didn't write the code.
That's
so.
A cop out.
No, it ain't a cop out.
Handicapped people in wheelchairs need to be able to get in and out of these buildings without hurting themselves and without having to struggle and fight themselves.
Well, maybe you need to go work on the codes then. That's all I can tell you. All right.
But we'll be glad to get with inspections and maintenance, and again, we'll try to have it within 30 days.
Okay, very good. All right, first up, approval for the agenda for the evening. Any additions, deletions, anything?
Mr. Chair, if we could, agenda 5A, or the project ordinance for Alamance Community College Bonds. There was some additional information that we needed from ACC, and we did not get that information in time for our agenda packet.
Okay.
So we would need to remove that and do that at our next meeting.
Okay. Just delete that out.
September 19th.
Just move it to September 19th. Okay. Any other additions, deletions, anything we need to look at?
All right, with that said, then I ask for a motion to approve.
I am, and I'll second that.
Okay, thank you, David. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, next we have the consent agenda. Is there anything that needs to be pulled to discuss, or are we okay with everything?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Okay. Second. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, planning department, public hearing, revision to the ordinance for the historic properties. And who's speaking, Jessica or Libby?
Libby.
Okay.
We swapped back today. Thank you for your patience while I was out of town. We are here to hold a public hearing today as allowed by the board to revise the Historic Properties Commission ordinance. These revisions were generally minor and editorial, as we stated. It would bump the commission down from 11 to 9 members. Also, it would clarify some about our jurisdictions, how to work with inspections department and do our certificates of appropriateness, make sure those are all in line with the North Carolina general statutes. Any of the municipalities that we have agreements with to be their Historic Properties Commission, we've also asked them for any feedback. And I don't believe we've received any, so.
The guy that was at our last meeting that was volunteering his services, has he gotten?
He lives in Graham, which is one of our jurisdictions.
Okay.
Plus, it sounds like this is kind of common sense anyway. Didn't your notes say that two of the positions have been unfilled for a couple of years?
That's right.
I mean, and everything works fine without it, so it makes sense.
I mean, 11 is that's a large board.
Yeah.
Okay.
We've had trouble filling those positions for years. I don't know why, but we haven't.
And we try. We actively go out and try to recruit. One of our board members is here today, Mr. Ballon. Just is, I suppose, what it is.
So. Of course, as we saw in the paper, a lot of things get torn down as you go through the county. Yeah. All right. Well, I guess our job is to set up a public hearing. And when are we thinking of doing that?
Oh, well, we've already advertised this.
Yeah, okay,
this would be
so we need to have a motion to conduct a public hearing.
So moved.
Okay. Thank you, David.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. I'll take comments from the audience if we have any.
Old Glencoe School, was it on the historic properties? It was. So
it was on the National Register.
Come on up and talk.
It was on the National Register of Historic Places, but not a local landmark. They're two different programs.
More word games?
No.
So,
That's just what it was.
The National Register of Historic Places is a federal program with no oversight of properties. A local landmark program has oversight of the properties with the owner's permission, and they get a 50% tax deferral in exchange for that oversight.
Similar to the Mill and Mevin furniture factory.
Well, I was just wondering how long it would take to get a place like the Old Glencoe School from a registry to tore down to a Dollar General new building going in.
Doesn't look like it takes too long. Yeah.
With all them tax breaks, about like Norwood Glencoe.
Well, I believe that particular property wasn't enrolled in the local tax program because it was not a local landmark.
Right.
Do you want me to clarify on that at all?
You can. That'd be
fine. Jessica spoke a little bit about it already, but. The historic landmark program is purely voluntary, and they do not have a way to prevent properties from being torn down. That's not what the program is for. The local landmark potentially could, and that would only be a delay. It wouldn't be a prevention. The flip side of that is we don't have funding to provide to fix up some of these buildings, so. It's not a fix-all,
right.
Just being a landmark. So,
is there anything in these changes to the bylaws that would help facilitate, that could have facilitated the protection of that school?
If it had applied for the local landmark status, there is an abatement. How do you phrase that in the ordinance?
There isn't anything in the ordinance that would have affected it. There is a delay of 365 days before a certificate of appropriateness can be issued by the commission. And the whole point of that is to hopefully find somebody who would perhaps buy the property and preserve it as opposed to demolition. But legally, the HPC cannot stop a demolition. They cannot deny it.
Thank you. I meant ordinance, not bylaws. But thank you.
And the other part of that is if there is a private transaction and somebody wants to sell their property, who wants to tear it down, there's really not a lot we can do.
Right. Any other comments for the public hearing? All right. With that, I'll take a motion to go out of the public hearing.
So moved.
Thank you, Linda.
I'm second.
Thank you, Bob. In favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. And next, we have Dude Solutions Facility Assessment presentation.
Do we need to?
We need to pass.
Pass the.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Revisions to the ordinance.
My fault. Yes, I'll take a motion to pass the change in the number of members.
So moved.
Sir.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. My bad. All right.
Pleasure to be here. Thanks for having us. So we wanted to meet with you guys today to talk a little bit about facility condition assessment and what that would mean for the county. And my name is John Mills. I'm a sales manager at Dude Solutions. We are based right down the road in Cary. We've been working with Alamance County for about almost 6 years now. So we've been working with the facilities team with just software so far, and what we're proposing here would help elaborate and expand on that. I want to introduce my colleague Cliff Ward, who is actually a director, sorry for the mistake there, professional services senior director. Emily couldn't make it tonight, she's sick, but I did want to introduce you to Cliff. He may handle some of the more technical questions if we get into that. So where I wanted to start tonight is just kind of where we've been with Alamance County. And I just want to recognize you guys because we work with 900 local governments specifically, 9,000 clients total across the country. And of the almost 1,000 government clients we have, you guys are in the top 10% as far as just productivity in your actual usage of our system, and of actually just being productive as a facilities team. So I wanted to recognize that because our median, you'll see, is about 161 work orders per person per year. That's full-time employees. And the Alamance team is somewhere around 388. That's well over double what our median is. So puts you guys in that higher echelon. What I want to get to today, again, the facility condition assessment, what we're talking about solving is a few main things. And again, this is completely different than like a performance contract, which I think was alluded to earlier. This is not a shared savings, any kind of program like that. There's certainly a place for that kind of thing. This is different. So the challenge we solve, or the challenge we're looking to overcome, are things like to understand a very detailed perspective on our facilities. So we want to understand all of our facilities, what's going on in all of them, and we want to have an unbiased approach to that. So not only biased in terms of like we can't sell you a service, like we're gonna replace this piece of equipment, or we're gonna be your contractors for facility maintenance. We don't do that. We can't do that. That's not the way we're set up. But it's also internally, you might walk past that crack in the sidewalk every day and just not really think about it anymore. So having a third party come in and verify that is critical. Another big piece of this is prioritization. So once we get this really comprehensive understanding of our facilities, we want to stack rank those. We want to say, so we have all these needs, right, across all of our facilities. So what is the most important? What is maybe the biggest safety issue, ADA, those kinds of important things that we want to address first, and what things come second and last?
So you are looking at ADA. That was my question earlier.
ADA does come into this.
What we do with our standard assessments, we can provide any level of ADA assessment that's needed. There's actually three levels of an ADA assessment, 1, 2, and 3. Typically, the first level is what I suspect that Alamance County has in place, where you have looked at the code and you're voluntarily doing things to make yourself compliant with ADA code. The assessment related to the second level is typically when there's a federal complaint and you get a visit by the feds here saying, we have a complaint from a citizen about your ADA compliance. And then there's actual inspections and things to be done to look at that. And the third is when you've actually been cited by the federal government and you have to put a plan in place to make corrective actions. And of course, ADA, a lot of people think of things in terms of mobility that may result in somebody being in a wheelchair and things like doors that are difficult to open, that kind of thing. But ADA also, there's a component that deals with folks that are sight impaired. There's the one where people are also sound impaired. And so there's all kinds of levels. It's actually quite complex. It usually starts with a discussion about the ramp's too steep, the door won't open, but in fact, it's a much more complicated thing. What we do with our assessments is when we're doing the facility condition assessment, we also observe things, and gross violations of ADA matters will include those within it, but we only include those gross violations. We don't go up and measure the height of the button at an elevator, although that's a part of ADA compliance.
Right.
So we do the gross violations. So there is a component to it, but only at a very high level.
Thank you.
Thanks, Cliff. And so kind of going down the list, I know we have a particular amount of time. We don't want to occupy the whole meeting here. So preventive maintenance is important, being proactive in your facilities. That is to extend the life of our equipment and to avoid costly failures. That's going to be a piece of this as well. We want to avoid capital surprises. Those are costly and always are never fun to deal with as an elected body. You guys talked about this earlier. You know, should we have sold a certain property? Should we sell a certain property? Should we keep it? Some of these decisions are business decisions and based on money, and these are going to give you the kind of facts and data to help you evaluate those things. And then there's the idea of capital budgeting, which all of this kind of leads into this idea of we want to know how much all of our facilities are worth. What does it take to keep our facilities sustainable? How much do we need to put into capital planning to do that?
And when, too, I think, right?
Mm. Absolutely.
Five years from now, or 10 years from now, or next year. Like.
Absolutely. And understanding if maybe 3 years from now there's a whole lot of things coming due, maybe we need to do something in year two and push a couple till year four. So leveling out those peaks and troughs and understanding, you know, this isn't something we have to just deal with so reactively year to year. Let's get ahead of it and think 20, 30 years out. So what we're proposing is four main items in this facility condition assessment. The first one is the facility condition assessment itself. It's the evaluation. It's the actual report and the analysis of what we just talked about, those needs. The second thing is gathering a full equipment list of all the valuable equipment within all of these facilities and backfilling the actual system that Richard Hill's team uses in facilities so that they can start logging a history against those pieces of equipment. That helps them make really strong educated decisions on, you know, how much money, how much time have we put into this piece of equipment. So that's a piece of this. We're going to backfill everything, the whole system that they're using with all their equipment data. Secondly, again, you guys have our platform. We're going to equip or populate your account with all of this capital data as well. So looking 30 years out, 20 years out, we're going to actually put that in our system, and it's going to be a living, breathing way to manage this data. So not only is this a really great snapshot today of all your facilities and what all the needs are, it's going to equip the facilities team in Alamance County to look at and say, 3 years from now, 10 years from now, we've been keeping up and manipulating this software, this solution that helps us continually understand what that snapshot is going forward. And then lastly, and this one's really big, there's a big ROI on this, being preventive and being proactive. We're actually going to build custom preventive maintenance schedules. That is all of the routine maintenance, that's the filter changes, that's the belt changes, that's everything we're doing on all this equipment. We're going to build those unique preventive maintenance schedules into the system so that Richard can start, and the facilities team can start documenting all that preventive work they've been doing also. And remember to do the right ones at the right time, extend the life of your equipment. That's in a nutshell what we're looking to do. How are we doing on time, guys? Doing fine. Cliff, can you give us a 60-second overview of how an actual facility condition assessment goes?
The 75-second story.
All right.
The way we do this, we've actually, to date, my team actually put this program together to be able to put this together. We've done about, I think right now, last time I looked, about 155, 160 of these in the last year and a half. What we do is our team gets together. It starts before we actually arrive on site. We do some interviews, get some basic background information. Because you're already a client of ours, a lot of that information is already there to get set up. We make sure everything's validated to be able to do capital planning against it. Get ready to come on site. When we come on site, what the teams are doing is they're working with your staff. They're actually doing inventory of the buildings themselves. They're also reviewing drawings. And what we're doing here is we're not trying to identify opportunities for energy savings. What we're trying to do is we're trying to tell you what's the condition of your facility itself. What's the condition of your roof? What's the condition of the wall system? If it's a stone wall system, if we observe evidence of foundation settling through some cracks in the second floor, our staff knows how to look at that and knows what to do to identify that. All the things that are important for you to know, what happens as a result of that then, after we're on site, we come back and put together the narrative reports. There's often some dialogue that takes place back and forth because the ways people like to do capital planning can vary from one county to another. And so we want to honor the things, the way that you want to have your plan come together. So we have those interviews. Ultimately, you end up with a narrative report that gives you the condition of those buildings, exactly where they are. There's also a thing called a facility condition index that gets issued. That index number typically is a good way to look and see. You may have buildings here that are built that are not the oldest buildings, but perhaps because of the way they've been maintained and the way just the weather and things have affected them, they may cost far more money to maintain over time than some of your oldest buildings that would take less money to bring them up to snuff. This is all the type of thing you discover through a facility condition assessment. With that index, you can rank your buildings. You're likely to find, if we're looking at 40 buildings, I'd be surprised if we didn't have two or three buildings that really may cost more money to fix than it is to replace. You may also find some buildings that you expected to be able just to tear down that in reality aren't going to cost that much money to bring up to snuff. You find that from that detailed study, and that's what we present to you as a part of it. So that comes there. After we do all this, you have the narrative report. Then all the information goes into the capital forecasting software. That software, again, as John said, is kind of a living, breathing thing, so that as you do the roof, as you do the other repairs, it gets updated, so 5 years from now, your capital plan is as accurate then as the one today. You're not going to be in a situation 5 years from now where you have to spend another $60,000 to get an assessment. You just update what you have and have it and use it on an ongoing basis. So that, in a nutshell, is kind of what happens.
Got a question. You said something about equipment also, right?
Right.
Does that equipment also contain the sheriff's cars and emergency vehicle equipment, or the equipment in the buildings, in the structure?
Focus on facilities only.
Okay.
Yeah, we concentrate on the building facility.
Okay.
What we may refer to in the industry as MEP, mechanical, electrical, and plumbing. So right. Basically all the HVAC, the plumbing, the electrical thing, the panels and things. I will say that along with this, we've had a number of counties that had their vehicles that they wanted to also maintain in their system. And what we've done with those, we don't charge anything for it. We get a list of those vehicles. Typically it's the vehicle information, the VIN number. It's usually available through whoever does your insurance. They've got a list of these things already. We import that at the same time, no additional charge, just to get it in the system. Certainly can do that in this case.
I guess that's what I was thinking, is the sheriff has X number of cars, and
yeah.
In the system, you could have in the projected end of life or whatever.
Right. We can get the information in there. What we can't do is we can't judge the condition of those vehicles. We can help you get it into the software that your guys have to decide what the condition of this thing is. But we can get it into the system for you easily enough. And that goes for anything. You know, in hospitals, I've had them do things that are out of scope that they wanted to get in, we import in. It's all part of the initial interview process. If you've got something that you want to get in the system, you've got an electronic list, we'll add that without a problem.
Very good. So I'll kind of finish with just why us, why this makes sense. And I think the partnership we've had thus far has been great, and we want to extend that. We hope to make this capital improvement process, this capital improvement endeavor, a success that goes well into the future. So we think this will save the county a whole lot of money. This will help you guys make some great decisions on your assets. We want to extend the life of your equipment and continue to elevate Alamance as a leader in facilities management. So we're excited about the future. I'll just say, here's my information. Are there any other questions, anything else we can address for you?
What other counties have you done this for?
Good question. So, and Cliff may be able to speak to a few more. I know Forsyth County is a good example of this. Montgomery County in North Carolina, City of Monroe. Cliff, any other stick out to you?
Yeah, Moore County, I guess, was one of the early ones we did. But I think you're in North Carolina.
Yeah, so we've done this many, many times over. So we can speak to that and give you guys references.
Is this something we're going to vote on tonight, or is this for information?
I prefer not to, but I mean, I think it needs further discussion.
Like, I agree.
Amongst us, yes.
Well, I would just say, Mr. Reitenberry, I did call Christie at Pepco today. We had a nice, really nice conversation. And so he explained the model that they use. And it's really the same as what I heard from Brady Train when they presented to our Board of Education. And it's a program, yes, it doesn't cost anything up front, but what they do is that they're looking for energy savings, and they guarantee, so they do some assessment, isn't charging anything for it. Then when you get to the point where they think they can actually provide this service on a more comprehensive basis, then you engage in a contract, and they guarantee the energy savings, but they do the work on whether it's replacing light bulbs, putting in new windows, doing energy related kinds of improvements to buildings. So if it works correctly, then there's no cash flow involved, because their company's making a lot of money, but it's being paid for out of savings. The county, or in this case the school system, would be saving the energy cost in order to pay for the fees to improve the facilities. So I was wondering, if when you do your facility assessments, which I'm really in favor of, because we just don't do a good job of planning, and this is a great planning tool for facilities. That's really expensive assets that we have to maintain, and I'm always being concerned, do we have too many buildings and we have a lot of square footage? Do we have too much of that? And this isn't going to answer that question.
Yeah, that is one of the problems I see. Yes, it does tell you the condition of the building. Are we utilizing those buildings to the best?
But that would probably take another planning organization, right, like an architectural firm or something like that, to do functional programming and see who could be co-located together and what efficiencies could get out of that. But this, though, the question I had with the Board of Education was, do you want to put a lot of improvements to a building to save energy when the building itself isn't warranted, isn't worth investing money into for other reasons? And so this, doing this first might help to help prioritize which buildings you would want to have. So my question is, with all that, have you worked with counties who went ahead and done the project that you're proposing here for us, and then using that information in conjunction with another firm like Brady Train or Pepco to come back and do more of an energy evaluation and focus on the right buildings to do that?
Right, yeah, and that's a really good model.
I might be able to address that. It's really, there's really three things we're talking about here in this, the midst of your statements there. You talk about the capital plan. Our tool is a capital forecasting right. tool. A condition assessment tells you the condition of what you have today, and then we have our software that allows you to do forecasting for those expenditures that are coming down the road. There's a second thing that's referred to as a capital plan. As you say, maybe an architectural A&E firm that might do a plan. If you had an A&E firm that was presenting to you today to do a capital plan, they would tell you the first thing we're going to do in our capital plan is we're going to do a facility condition assessment. That facility to condition assessment is going to cost you 10 to 12 cents a square foot. I have to look at what the, I don't even know what the square footage is, but you guys have
580,000, I think.
Right at a half million square feet.
Yeah, so you're going to look in there and you're going to have that. So we're in the neighborhood there. Then on top, once the facility conditions, once you know the condition of your buildings, then we'll come in and we'll put this plan together for you. And typically the capital plan may cost a similar amount to a condition assessment, depending on what detail that planning is and those kind of things. Every week we end up having A&E firms that come to us and say, hey, we're bidding on a job at such and such place where we have an RFQ for a capital plan. We need a condition assessment before we do our capital plan, and we want to use your software. So it's a subcomponent of that plan. Now, the other thing you talked about in terms of the performance things or the energy savings things, it's really an apples and oranges, totally separate deal. There, what you're looking at, you're saying, okay, looking at this building, can I change something about the mechanical system in this building and save enough money in the process to pay for itself? I can tell you right off the bat, if you have a mechanical system older than 20 years and you're not using the latest lighting technology, I can come in for $10, tell you, do those two things, give me my check, and let me go eat lunch. That's all it takes to usually pay for a performance contract. So it's a different thing. There, when you come in for an energy audit and that kind of savings, you still don't know if you've got a roof that doesn't leak. You don't know if you have a foundation that's going to last. You don't know if you have window systems that are the best. Now, they may come in and say, okay, you know, those are single-pane windows. If we come double-pane windows, you'll see this kind of energy savings.
Right, they do that.
So since spend that money. So that you do get some piece of it. What you don't get is you don't get an entire picture of the condition of a facility, and you also are tied then to when you enter that contract with those folks, they're going to identify those things for free. They can give you energy savings. Remember I said it cost me $10 to get me to do it. You can get those things for free, and then you're going to pay them to actually do that work. And again, it's a very apples and oranges different kind of thing. But it's tempting because it's free, and we see governments, we see people go down that rabbit hole, and 5 years later they come back and say, you know, we need the condition of our facilities. You may still end up, it's two different things. It might be worthwhile to do that if you're willing to tie yourself to that one company, do that, and do a facility condition assessment, because the two don't overlap.
Well, I think, yeah, I kind of sense that after talking to this gentleman from Pepco is that there's maybe a certain amount of overlap.
If they replace the chiller in this building, you look at, yeah, it's new.
Right.
So what have you done?
Get that chiller, that new chiller, into our system so your guys can maintain that to get maximum use out of it.
Right.
You still want that in the system. Yeah.
I don't understand what we're doing here. I don't know what this company's been doing for the last 6 years. We have to change something or add something or pay more money. And I don't want to hear any more, and I'd just like to have somebody explain what we've done for six years and then go from there.
Well, what we've used Facility Do to begin with is they've kind of been our automated work order process. So we can go online instead of calling Richard or calling maintenance, you can go online and put your work order in, and then our maintenance people can automatically get messages and saying that this work order is in. If you are to get it and you're at DSS, you can do it while you're there. So it really has helped automated our work order system. It's helped us be a lot more effective and efficient than we have been in the past. Instead of waiting for the beginning of the day to get a list of work orders that may have been called in or emailed in, this will automatically update our maintenance crew in an immediate fashion. It did that?
Perfect.
Okay.
Well done.
Being as there was a complaint done against me with the register deeds over there, and here's the state documents. Would you like to hear what happens in
Tony, that's all right.
Y'all done it, not me.
Well, you're not in this part of the discussion. Thank you.
Well, I think
should be.
I think we should consider it, and maybe we do it at another meeting. But I mean, we have 40 buildings, and to have a comprehensive assessment of all of them, I think would be a great tool for future planning of our facility.
I've got just maybe one more question there about the staff that comes in to do these evaluations. What are their qualifications? Are they structural engineers? Are they?
Yeah, the staff that actually does the assessment itself, from the beginning planning stages through the time that the narrative report's written, involves a variety of people. Some of them may be young mechanical engineers. They're also going to have an architect, a senior staff engineer, structural engineers. If the crew that comes out to actually do the observations may be a young mechanical engineer that makes observations, goes back, says, hey, building number 32, we observed these cracks in the buildings. This is the photographs of what it is. The structural engineers looking at that saying, okay, this is this situation, that situation, and do it.
Do you have a place we could go to look at the credentials of your personnel as far as people in your staff? Yeah, I don't really want to do anything tonight, so. Okay, thank you very much, Zach. Appreciate it.
If there is additional information that the board needs, just let us know. When would you like us to try to bring this back? Or I don't know, actually.
Well, I have the advantage of actually going to visit their facility, so I have a little bit up on
right.
A little more information. And
yeah.
So.
Any suggestions on time frame? Maybe something.
3 months.
3 months?
Yep. I won't be here.
Well, you know, and that is an issue. Mr. Smith, that is an issue because this board could end up with Bob being the only man here that was involved.
I mean, well, it's going to change. At least three of us are going to be gone come 3 months. So.
Yeah, hopefully
four. All right.
I think it'll be three.
But anyhow,
but if you need additional information, just let me know, and we'll get back with you on that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Next, we have Todd with the school system. He's got a few pictures to bring to us and show us what they've been doing this summer.
Good evening, everyone. Just really wanted to give you an update. I come to you, ask for money. I come to tell you all these great things that we do. So I thought it was time to sort of bring some pictures and show you what we've done and show you. I'm not going to ask for anything from you tonight. I'm not going to promise you the next time I show up. But
very pleasant words.
Right yes, there. Yes. This is really for your enjoyment. If you just want to see, if you got questions, feel free to stop and ask. I'm not going to spend a lot of time. But I just want to give you a brief overview. Our summer's been very busy. We painted five additional high schools this year. I mean, five additional schools, two high schools, two middle schools, and an elementary school. Now, this work takes a lot of people. You know, it starts from planning on our side, going to our board saying we need to do this, coming to you saying we need to do this. I've got all your staff working in the background, my staff working in the background to come up where the money's going to come from, the planning piece. I have to thank our inspectors, our fire marshals, all of them, they work great with our guys. Our guys are willing to go and say, hey, listen, you know, we're going to do this. What do we need to do? So, you know, a lot of people go into making this. I got 40 maintenance guys that have worked themselves to death this summer. 10 weeks to turn over this kind of work is a lot of work. But, you know, like I said, we painted the five schools. We did gym floor replacement at three schools, two major ones. Cellar gun was more of a repair, but the picture to the right, if you've been in the Ray Street gym, it used to be tile floor. This is the rubberized floor. It looks just like a hardwood from a distance, but it is a rubberized floor. A lot of our children use this gym. Parks and Rec uses it a lot. It's a highly used gym. To the left, you see Cummins. It had the original floor that was put in 1970. Over time, it needed a replacement. Gym floors painted. We got four elementary schools. We painted the activity centers on the floors. Many of them hadn't been painted in 8 to 10 years. The lines were fading. The kids couldn't see them. Our PE teachers use that for instructional purposes. So it's actually an opportunity for our children to enjoy different activities. Some of those activities you see have been forgotten. Stuff we played when we were little growing up, hopscotch and some of the other things. This is a way to introduce them back to some just fun games. carpet removal and tile installation. We did two media centers this year. We added some extra tile at Alexander Wilson, and I just took on Jordan's elementary school today. I mean, Durham Media Center today. We assessed our carpet, and we really felt like we need to do something for the kids to get back. It was affordable for us this year, so we went ahead and we took that project on today for this year. Pleasant Grove, many of you saw, this used to be the pre-K center. It was carpet with asbestos tile underneath. When we removed everything, put the tile floor back, it really looks nice. It is conducive for learning. South Graham Stage area, same thing, total abatement and tile installation. Concrete repairs. We're kind of like, you know, you talk about different repairs that's been deferred and deferred and deferred, and concrete is one that we've deferred to the point that we can't defer it any longer. We had several areas where stumps, trees have grown up and raised the concrete, which is a trip hazard. Some of it's just old concrete. It's come apart, it's busted up, it's dangerous for children. So we did a quick assessment and determined what we needed to replace and made those replacements. Modular classrooms, Western Middle and South Mevin. This is a picture of South Mevin. South Mevin actually has three classrooms that feeds into its own corridor, which has restrooms and everything. So it's like a little mini school within a school. So it's very much self-contained for those students. It's much better than the mobile unit we removed, as an old unit. It was a 1970 some model unit that was removed. The repairs were going to be close to $30,000. It wasn't worth the repairs. We bought the whole modular unit for.
Do you underpin that, or is it?
Yeah, I can't. It will be underpinned. We will before we finish it. We were hooking water and sewer up today. So once that's hooked up, our ramps will go in, and we get the floors finished, and we should be pretty much on schedule to have it open by the time students get here, which is 2 weeks, and we're counting every second of it.
Countdown.
Classrooms. I know that sounds crazy, but I'll strip down to Broadview and Cummins. Broadview and Cummins had these large locker pods that used to be in the corners of the building that were removed several years ago. Kids don't use lockers anymore. And it was sitting as open space, and they were needing additional space. So it was an excellent opportunity for us to go in and make classrooms in that area. Andrews and South, well, Andrews was an area to where, if you've ever been in Andrews, it's a sort of a round building, and there's some odd corners in there. And it's wasted space for what we're using it for, but it made excellent small classroom space, small tutoring area. So we was able to go in there and create those areas. South Mevin had a large area that was still left from the open classroom concept. They were having three classrooms with partitions in between the rooms, which was not conducive for learning. The noise travels, students, and you know, teachers, I've taught in an area like that. You have a tendency to get louder. So the next one gets louder. It becomes this challenge of which teachers will get the loudest. And we were able to go in and make three really nice classrooms in there today. We just finished that today. They should be doing the floors probably as we speak now, getting the tile floors finished and ready for students. The Turntide Middle Walkway, we've all talked a whole lot about this. It has come a long ways. We poured the top floor, the upper level. We poured it on Friday. We poured the steps today. We should see railing start tomorrow. The awning should start at least by Wednesday. Expected to have fully up and going by the time students arrive.
Is that the Todd Thorpe?
That's going to be the Todd Thorpe Memorial, is what Dr. Harrison said. Pleasant Grove awnings. Once it's visited Pleasant Grove, we kind of brag about it because the awning looks so bad. We went out and had a little work done, put a little paint on it, and it makes a world of difference just to clean it up. It makes you feel better about walking into the building.
Mm-hmm. Looks good.
South Graham mobile units. With our mobile units, many times they become more of a permanent structure, and the shingled roofs, they begin leaking. We found out, you know, for cost, it's just as cheap for us to put a metal roof on them. Then we can use them for as long as we need to. It doesn't stop us from moving the units if we ever choose to. Grand Middle Makerspace. You know, Makerspace is a new hot term in education. Makerspace can be a lot of different things. It's really an opportunity for a child to be creative in the ways they want to be creative in. Some will be more STEM oriented, some may be more engineering oriented, some may be more technology. it can go so many different directions, and some might just be hands-on activities. This was a room, if you've ever been to Grand Middle School, if you walk in the gym to the back doors to the inner circle, here's a room to the right. It had about three layers of carpet on it, had an old partition in the middle, had 1960 lights in it. We put the lights out, put LED panels in it. Couldn't use LED drop-ins. We had to go to the panels because of not enough distance in the between the drop ceiling. Put new ceiling in it. You know, for a few thousand dollars, we made a space much more conducive for learning. These are some additional projects we've done. At E.M. Yoder, we added a new pre-K, which required us to put in a bathroom. We just passed inspection there last week. So this week we're finishing up at a fire truck bay at Graham High School. As you know, Graham High School, we're starting the fire academy there this year, trying to promote our local needs. We need folks coming out of school trained. We've got door replacements at, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 schools. Just, they're old. That's all I can say for them. They're old, they're tired. The auditorium lobby at Williams, we decided that, you know, it looked its age. It needed an upgrade, so we did an upgrade there. AO had a lot of canopy that was beyond repair, had a lot of wooden poles, tin roofs, you know, stuff that was done years ago to get by. But, you know, nowadays it's cheaper to go back with aluminum, and with aluminum it's there forever. So we've done the canopy repairs there. That says 937 work orders. I probably should have updated. I think we're a little over 1,100 work orders and still coming in. We do school dues is who we do with our work order system through. So same organization you're working with. And they keep track, and it actually works out very well.
So you just did the work order part?
We're just doing the work order part. Actually, I do have the paperwork on my desk when I'm doing an assessment to see what it would cost to do our buildings.
Well, Dr. Thurb, I really appreciate you presenting all this to us. I do remember, though, not too long ago we had a complaint about bathrooms. I think it was Western High School.
Yes, sir.
I didn't see anything about that.
Well, because we didn't have to get lottery or bond money for that. We painted Western High School. So we went in, we painted down to the tiles. We have steam cleaned the restrooms, which we do every summer anyway, and replaced all the...
I think some of the stall doors weren't working.
We replaced any broken stall doors. Right. We also just doing that at Cummins.
Dispensers.
Soap dispensers are all brand new. Paper towels are all brand new. Toilet tissue dispensers are all brand new. So we went in and just did a total upgrade there as we were painting. We just considered that as part of the painting project.
Taken care of.
Yeah.
That's the way we like to hear that.
All right.
Need your camera on there so you find out who told them.
What was the total cost?
We spent about a little over $3 million this summer by the time we complete everything. But, you know, as you know, things are not cheap.
That's a lot of schools. Yeah. You're touching each one of those.
Yeah, in 10 weeks, I have to go back and say, you know, 10 weeks is a very short turnaround to complete this much work.
I appreciate you bringing us up to date because that's good work.
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Thank you, Todd, very much.
I want to applaud you for Ray Street Gym. I won't tell you how many years ago it's been. But I used to play basketball there, and we used to have to dodge the pigeons.
That was a long time ago, man. All right, very good. Timber appraisal contract, I think our county attorney is going to bring us up to date with that.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, everybody. You have before you a timber appraisal contract. We're going to put out about 118 acres of timber to be cut at the landfill. It was thinned in 2010, and now it needs to be cut. And the appraisal contract would involve hiring Henderson Forestry to come in and prepare a written appraisal of the timber, the value of the timber, and to prepare a request for bids as we're required to do under the statute. We would prepare a request for bids and a resolution. We'd advertise in the paper for the sealed bids. The sealed bids would be opened and presented to the board, and the commissioners could decide whether to accept them or not. So, this is step one in a two-step process, timber appraisal contract.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Very good. And the next item, we're skipping that one on Susan, but she does still have another one to bring us up to date on our financial good beings.
I do. Good evening, Commissioners. Tonight I'm going to present our fourth quarter financial update as of June 30th, 2016. There we go. We ended our general fund budget a percent change of 4.18%. We had an amended budget of $148,491 from the approved adopted budget of $137,000. For our revenues, we collected 101% of what we had budgeted. And we'll see the breakdown below. We had property tax revenue. We saw an 11% increase there. Sales tax, 9.6%. Other taxes and license, 10.3%. Intergovernmental was 1.1%. Sales and services, 1.9%. License and permit, 8.7%. Investment earnings, 677%. And miscellaneous of 37%. So our overall increase in revenues was 8.5% over what we did during fiscal year 14-15. Expenditures, we kept them the same. 94% of our budget was spent. The percent change between our actuals of 128 for fiscal year 15 versus 135 for fiscal year 16 was 5.6%. Revenues over expenses at the end. The previous year, we had expenses over revenues of $2 million. This year, we are having revenues over expenses of 1.5. Our other financing sources, we are at a decrease of $474,000. We had transfers out to other funds for those. With the $3.4 million you're seeing there in fiscal year 14-15 was where we had the sale of Peak, so that was another financing source. Net effect so far this year with 15-16 is $1,065,000 over revenues and expenses. And that is what I have for tonight, Commissioner.
Is that the same as saying our fund balance is going to increase by that amount?
Our fund balance will actually increase more than that because that does not include our accruals. We're still in the process of gathering those. Revenues are still coming in August. Expenses are still going out in August. Once August is complete, we will have those final numbers.
And when will the auditors start?
They've actually already started. They were in the first week of August doing their financial. Then, of course, they still have to wait for us to finish up August, and so they'll finish that up by October. Okay. So they're right on track.
Very good, and the bond sale went really good. And
bond sale was awesome. We good. Had a very That's successful
healthy
bond
fund
sale.
Balance helps.
Yes, it did. We were upgraded by Standard & Poor's to a AA, and our total interest cost is 2.07 over the life of the bonds for 20 years.
Very good.
And did I hear that if we hadn't gotten that bond rating increase, that we might have paid 15 basis points more? Perhaps,
that is correct. Okay. That is correct. I should have the final amortization schedule from the LGC shortly, and I'm going to do an analysis there to see what we actually were able to
save. I'd like to see that.
We'll have that for you.
All right.
And also, they paid a bond premium to bid on the bonds. So they paid a bond premium of over $1.1 million, mm-hmm. Which we can add to the project that we do not have to pay back.
I love that.
Yes.
Okay. All right, very good. Thank you, Susan. All right, County Manager.
Just a couple things. I do want to thank Susan Osborne and Commissioner Byrd for their help in the presentation to the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners on the Stepping Up Initiative. Really, really did a great job, and Susan did a lot of work of getting all the information ready for us, but it really turned out well. Got a lot of good compliments from those in attendance. I wanted to thank Susan for all her work on that as well. Also want to congratulate Commissioner Byrd. He was recently at that meeting appointed to the executive board of the County Association, and that is to fill out Dan Engel's seat until next year.
It'd be so, one year
term. Sure. And we do appreciate that. And as we talked earlier, and there was a press release in the paper, wanted to formally recognize Richard Hill, who agreed to move to our landfill as the new director, and we're excited for Richard and his new position. And also, that being said, we want to thank Buddy Weitzel, who is now our maintenance director, for taking over that role as well. And we're excited for both of them in their new leadership roles and capacities, and excited about the jobs that they will do. And also wanted to mention, we have finalized a joint meeting with the school board at our Cooperative Extension Building for September 14th. Breakfast will be at 8:30 a.m. And we'll
Are we buying?
We're buying this time. They bought last couple of times, so we'll buy breakfast this time.
Now this is breakfast.
Yes, sir. This will not
it's
be.
It's really going to have food, guys, right?
Mr. Parker has informed me that fruit and veg or fruit and
coffee.
There's more breakfast than fruit and coffee. So we'll have at least biscuits. So the Cooperative Extension main room. So we'll do that on September 14th, and we'll be able to talk about. I appreciate what Todd did tonight. Todd's still here, about the facilities task force, the joint committee that we have, and what the next steps are moving forward. So we appreciate the school board's willingness to do that. And that is all I have, if there's any questions.
I don't understand why we're having a meeting with the school board. I mean, like we mentioned before, three of us are not going to be here after December 5. And I don't think we can do anything that's going to bind the new board when it comes in, quite frankly. And if you want to keep me from going to a meeting, you start at 8 o'clock in the morning. And
that's a surefire way to keep you out.
Right? You got it. All
right. It's up to the board. We can.
Yeah. Well, the facility part, I think, still needs to be talked about. And
we're you know we
figure all that out
at the association meeting. I went to a workshop on the relationships between boards of education and boards of commissioners and the historic nature of it. And really, by law, the way this is set up is that it's kind of a joint responsibility to provide public education. And I just think any opportunity we have to communicate between the two boards, informal and informal ways, is time well spent.
Well, I look at it a little differently. The school board has a tough job. They're elected to do that job. County commissioners are elected to do the job. Ours is tough too, but I look at it that the county commissioners can, they're kind of a balancing act as to what the school system may want. I think the school system should come up with what they need, bring it to this board, and this board then considers it and sees whether we think that, or the board in the future. I don't see us helping them or them helping us out. I think it's both boards need to stay independent and do their jobs, and the public will be a lot more satisfied when that happens, if it happens that way. But I understand my colleagues don't agree with that, and that's fine. Socializing is okay, but just think it's a waste of time.
All right. Anything else? Okay, I'm going to make a motion that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11(a)(5). To instruct the Alamance County staff concerning the position to be taken by or on behalf of Alamance County in negotiating the price or other material terms of a contract or proposed contract for the acquisition of real property by purchase, option, exchange, or lease for the property located off of Austin Quarter Road, Graham, North Carolina, owned by the Bruce B. Cameron trustee, and for the purpose of producing a buffer for the county landfill and other purposes of the county. That's my motion. Can I get a second?
Sure.
Thank you, David. And also, I would also like to make a motion that we invite into our meeting Gil Johnson and Richard Hill to answer questions to the pertinent property and landfill.
Their staff.
Their staff, yeah. I'll make that motion.
Second.
Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, and we will go into closed session. Well, we have met and we consulted with the county attorney and considered and gave them instructions concerning the position to take on behalf of Alamance County in negotiating the price or other material terms of a contract for the acquisition of real property. And that's all I got to say about it.
That's all I got.
Any commissioner comments?
Move adjourned.
I'll second that, sir. I'll favor that.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.